part is psychomotor, where hands-on skills are there. So whenever you are writing learning outcome, it should have these three domains reflection. Now, taxonomy of cognitive domain. If I concentrate only on cognitive domain, we have again two. One is knowledge dimension, another is the process dimension. Okay? Now, knowledge dimension I'll be talking while I'll be doing in the exercise tutorial. Okay? You have the tomorrow tutorial, there I'll be talking. But process dimension, you know that six levels are there, which is known to you only. Bloom's six levels. Now, these levels are basically from Bloom's taxonomy, which is known to you also. You know, Bloom, it was taxonomy of cognitive objectives, concept started in 1950. But what happens, in 1990, Anderson, he changed the thought process little bit. So there is a transformation in Bloom's taxonomy also. It was revised. Revision was from noun to action verb. Okay? So we got the old one was this, the new one is this. Okay? So old one was this side. New concept by Anderson is that side, where I have marked one thing like HOTS and one thing like LOTS. The HOTS are the higher order thinking skill, LOTS are the lower order. And it is reflected in the whatever attribute given to Washington Accord, all HOTS are there. So whenever we are going to write the outcomes, that must focus to the HOTS, higher order thinking skill of our students. Okay? That is the base. And this part is known to you. Now, basically, then we are concentrating on HOTS. HOTS are from analyze, evaluate, and create. The language is this, analyze, evaluate, and create. Analyze when I have seen in writing CO, some of the COs are like writing analyze this. So writing analyze is not analyze. Remember that. Analyze means it is breaking information into parts to explore understanding and relationship. So that must be the job they are doing. Just I have written analyze means it will not take the outcome to that level. Okay? And there you can use the action verbs like compare, organize, deconstruct, interrogate, find, that. Okay? Now, like evaluate, I have seen also writing CO evaluate. Evaluate is not determine, not just find, not deduce. We use sometimes in the question paper, evaluate a problem, but evaluate meaning is not to calculate. Okay? So evaluate means justifying a decision or course of action. I am going to study two cases and then I am comparing the cases and writing my opinion about which one is the best. So when I am doing that, that's the evaluation. Okay? So outcome must be at that level. So check, hypothesize, criticize, experiment, give judgment on. If you start with that CO, then it becomes that. Okay? Similarly, create. Create means generating new ideas, products, or ways of viewing things. So, design, construct, plan, produce, invent, these are the words, action verbs needed for create level. So, these are the three positions where I have to reflect in my outcomes. This picture is not so important. Going to this, Now, you know, today we all want from our 21st century learners all these attributes, a long list of attributes. And if you place, if you call industries, no, they will also tell you that we want this, we want this, we want this. So this has a long list of attributes, and it is the responsibility of us to develop in my students all this. Okay, so this is a guideline from the industry, and these are the 21st century learners' attributes needed. Now it is the time to interpret the graduate attributes. I told you that interpretation. Now first attribute is this, I have already interpreted that you have to, as a physics, chemistry, mathematics teacher, you have to show how the course is connected to engineering. What theory of basic science or mathematics is actually linking the theory of engineering where he is going to implement it? Examples must be related. If you can do it, you are going to put it in your plan, course file or lesson plan, where the examples are written there. So that will be an evidence for you to prove that you have a mapping with this PO. Okay, number two is when you are putting a question paper, that should be reflected there. So that will be a second proof or evidence for justifying that you are connected with your science course, you are connected with solving engineering problems. Okay, so and for engineering departments, you need to do it. All practical related problems or reality problem, you have to give example, give assignment, give them mini projects, do problem solving method, whatever may be. Okay, and you should keep a record of that to have to produce the linkage with this one. Number two, problem analysis. Now, this problem analysis means identify, formulate research literature, then analyze complex problem, again by first principle of mathematics. So, first year teachers can have a mini project or problem based learning in the first year itself, involving science and mathematics. The concept can be there. If you can do, where problem is given, they are formulating the problem, thinking of the first principle, how to apply the mathematics first principle to solve that problem. If they can do it, you can relate it. So interpreting the second statement means this. And this is true for other engineering courses also. I cannot think of going to the fourth year and then giving a project for this. I have to practice it from the first year itself. The problem depth will be less because as they will be growing, the problem difficulty level will be growing. But I can give up simple problems which is unknown, and they are going to library, they are searching internet, and they are solving it by themselves. Okay? Design development of solutions. So design solutions for complex engineering problem which is related to social issues. Now, do I know that how my course is related to social issues? Now, ma'am from chemistry know that pollution issue. I can arrange kind of awareness problem with society. I can give my students a simple problem of water related pollution to the society, my students, and can have a kind of any laboratory experimentation or something which is special, which is not maybe not included in the 10 experiments that I have, can be the 11th experiment, but can I do it? So this is again not for the final year or fourth year or third year higher level. This can also start. So where is the scope and that is by the teachers only. They can only think of that. I, as an expert, can only think. It is not that somebody else will be giving you the idea. It is the idea where I can handle my students with solving problems related to social issues and connected to my own course. Okay? Conduct investigations of complex problems. That's also when I have a problem, I am giving them a scope for analyze the problem, and if possible, I can give them a scope for investigate the problem. My lab, where they can also do that investigation. Can I? They can study some data also, can have a kind of a result, can publish a paper also on that issue. I am guiding them. So that can be done. So this is the fourth one. Now complexity is already written. So no need of having any kind of confusion in that, because it is already documented, and all the things may not be, but there some can be one or two points which you can make. Modern tool uses that you are already doing. So only thing, IT tools, maybe your now everyone is using MATLAB or maybe the software Scilab, which is you can download and can use. So think of that IT tools which can be for experimentation. Engineers and society. Now this is, we are facing maybe the problem that how we are going to do it and again measure it. Okay, maybe reality field we are facing. So my question is, what are the activities we have decided for that? Again, we can always have that societal health safety issues connected to my own course. I am teaching a subject of maybe electrical engineering where that part is connected, but which is not very well written in the curriculum document. Now it is my job is to find out the issues related to society, issues related to legal things, etc. I am going to produce the power plant engineers. Then what are the issues that they may face there? Can I link it with my teaching when I am teaching them the utilization of power or something like that? So those issues can be and can be connected. Again, you can organize lectures, you can organize social visits, you can go to your locality, can extend your whatever help you can, conduct some kind of awareness program under that. So this, you have to do the activities, you have to reflect it in your plan, and you will be doing, having some kind of documentation. Environment and sustainability, that is also the impact of the professional engineering solutions in societal and environmental context. Demonstrate the knowledge of and need for sustainable development. Again, it is through your course only you have to do. Where is the scope for when you are teaching civil engineering subjects, then where is the scope for sustainable development? And see, anything, if I cannot connect with sustainability, the things will not remain. So I have to, as a teacher, I have to find out that one. And again, give that exposure to the student, if possible some activity, and if activity, then I have to note that, because I need to have again the evidences for that. Okay? Ethics. Now may I know what we are doing for ethics? This graduate attribute. This question I got yesterday from NIT, that particular NIT I told, that yes, how to put ethics in the curriculum. Should I put a paper of ethics, a course on ethics? Yeah, you want professional ethics. It's not the rules for ethics they will be writing in the exam hall. They will be professional. Professional and ethically doing that. So, see, we have to demonstrate that one. And demonstration must be through our courses only. Ethics is inbuilt in our engineering education. I have to find out where, what are the issues which is connected to my own course. I don't feel like that you are putting some external management person who is coming regularly, like periodically, and giving a lecture on ethics, and we can develop ethics in our students. I don't know where your condition, but I have seen in my West Bengal state, the ethics class is most unethical. Okay, a few students sitting in the front bench, after the attendance is over, they are leaving the classroom from the back door, a few students sitting, and they are also sitting like just for attendance. So, and because the paper is kept in the fourth year, so it is, they don't feel like I should have an exposure of ethics, and they may not be connect themselves for their professional career with the ethics taught in the class. I don't know your condition, but it is a true picture I am showing you. And the particular ethics paper not taken by the engineering teachers. So what is happening, the teacher is also an external person, visiting person, and he is doing that job from this institute to that institute. 1 hour from this institute, going to the next institute, he is a traveler and having that course. So this way, if we like to have ethics contribution and keeping a PO or graduate attributes of ethics, it is very hard to have any kind of mapping in the reflection. So maybe we can work together as an engineer, as an engineering teacher, we can find out professional ethics through our own courses and can contribute it. And we are demonstrator of that. When we demonstrate ethics, I think I can give it. Okay, so this is the thing, individual and teamwork. Again, my question is, if I cannot start it from the day one, when my students are entering into the institute, can I do it only in the fourth year project? Can I give them a certificate that yes, no doubt my students will be working in the industry and will be having that team leading, etc., etc.? So I have to practice it from day one when they are entering. So my classroom can have a kind of place where I am doing some activity through group learning. There will be team leader, though who will be responsible for the functioning of that group. That can change, that can rotate. Every teacher is having that kind of exercise, then all the students can be a team leader in any of the team. So department can think of the activities through which this can be done, okay? There can be multidisciplinary teams also, give them a project which may not be always like a knowledge-based project, some other projects also, activity-based something also, okay? So this, when we do practice it, again this will be reflected in our course file, that will be a part of my lesson plan, and then the assessment I am doing while they are doing that activity, that can be treated as an assessment tool. Because when they are doing something, I must have a rubric to give them some kind of assessment on the activity. And that will serve as evidence for this. Okay? Now communication. Communication, again, this communication is not that English 1 and 2 that is in the curriculum. It's not the responsibility of the English teacher, because it is again the professional communication, and again we must practice it from the day one. So again, this is a kind of activity that we are going to do in our class itself. The communication, presentation, self-teaching, self-learning, as well as group teaching, all those concepts must be there in my own plan when I am handling one paper, one course. And if I can do it, then this can be there. Project management and finance, this question also I got from that NIT. How to? Because, see, when we are joining as teacher, day one only, the authority is asking me that now you write DPR, okay, write a project, submit a project to that. Now how we will be trained? Can we not do whatever project they are doing, let them ask for writing that DPR for that, estimate that? They can do always. If they can do, there will be a thing, lesson learned by themselves. Because after that, while joining the, even joining as a teacher now, we are doing all kinds of purchase, everything. It is not a, somebody else is doing. Everything we as a teacher are doing. So every proposal we have to write. So let there be, they learn them from that one when they are doing it. Keep them, ask them. So they will be learning, and when that is ready, you have a ready document to show that they know this project management and the finance, because they are estimating the project also. Okay? The 12th one is surely the lifelong learning. And don't you feel if the 11th one can be done in that way, the 12th one is not very hard to do. Because everything you are doing, give them a kind of thing that they will be doing by themselves, a self-learning scope. Okay? You know, when we teach, what we teach? The content of the curriculum, which is nothing but information. Now, this information becomes knowledge through the processing. Okay? So, in the information, if you search, 60% of the information are factual. Rest are conceptual, procedural, and some part we call it metacognitive, which is knowledge out of knowledge or strategic knowledge, which I have to observe that what is the situation, when to talk. This self-knowledge is the fourth group of information or knowledge. Now the 60% of factual, can I not give them a percentage of that for self-learning? Because that is available in the books itself. Give them as assignment, give them a problem so that they can solve it and come out with the idea. Give them a group work to do the thing. We can. So it is only our task is to find out which part is factual, which the things are available in the net, in the book, in some in the library, and let them go there, search there, find out, write something, present it in front of others, let there be peer assessment for that, self-assessment for that, and that process will make them the 12th attribute. Okay? So lifelong learning is not the membership of, I have seen for the proof of evidence, the institute is keeping that they are member of IEEE, they are member of IEEE kind of thing. This is not the for lifelong learning. Lifelong learning is a skill they must develop. Wherever they go, they will be able to learn by themselves and cope up with the next, whatever technology coming or whatever situation they will be able to handle. So for that, we have to make them ready. And we want evidence, so we have to create something. So this is 10 more minutes. Okay? Because then I'll stop. Now this is the process. Now my question is, you are being an autonomous institute, have you written your own PO, program outcomes? Okay. Or you are sticking to the graduate attributes? Graduate attributes. So you have again the 12 POs as we have already. Only thing you may have written there, the engineering in place of engineering, mechanical engineering, civil engineering, computer science engineering, that change. Okay. So that's why this is the process. NBA already identifies the graduate attributes, which is basically the POs for you, okay? And then the stakeholder and committee members decided about the program specific outcomes, and these two are basically responsible for PSO, PO, PSO or PO matrix. Now here you need to work, how can I justify through my PSO or PO that my students will be having the attainment of PEOs. So the factors I need to find out. Okay, so this is the way you are doing. Now my question is, as you are telling that you are sticking to GS, then you have no problem with POs, writing POs, because it is the same thing. If you are not doing that, means you are making your own POs, you need to find out again a mapping with GS. Because the 12 GS given to you, graduate attributes, you have to establish a mapping between GS and the newly you have designed the POs, how they are connected. I cannot miss any graduate attributes from my POs. Okay? This is the thing. Now, this is clear to you, so I am not talking of Tier 1 and Tier 2. You told you are a Tier 1 as autonomous body. So these things, Tier 1 institutes, I need not show because you have already. Now, this is the POs written. These 12 are exactly as you told. The same way they are just transmitting that, writing the branch name, etc. This is also. Now, since you are not changing this, that's why you are requiring PSOs. PSOs means, have you written any PSO? Can you give any one example? Anyone. Anyone. Yeah, please.
Ma'am, it is graduate will be able to clearly understand the basic concept and application in the field of electronics and telecommunication engineering and to apply them to various areas like electronics and communication.
See, PSOs are why needed, can you tell me? Why? Why it is needed? You have 12 POs. One is, you have written the PEOs. I have shown you, POs are just below that. So POs are there to fulfill your attainment of PEOs. You found that your curriculum is not supporting 100% of that POs. You need some outcome which will be at the level of institution or program outcome level to meet that one. So PSOs are beyond the curriculum. If I again write the statement like clearly stating that indicates I am not doing justice to whatever is there in my curriculum itself. So I am putting again a force on clearly. So this cannot be an PSO. PSOs, number one, are beyond the curriculum. The outcome you want basically at this level, and the components not supporting to that. That's why I am in electrical department. Suppose my mechanical department is having a very good CAD-CAM center. And I know for electrical engineers also, this is a learning outcome, because I have written in my PEOs something like they will be designing something using modern tools, etc., etc. Okay? So I am extending the students that facility also, and I want an outcome related to that, which is not in my curriculum of electrical, but in addition, I am giving this. This program of electrical engineering having specific outcome on this also.
That will satisfy our
PEO. So that you can satisfy that one. Yes. Do you feel that is not there in the PO? This is already in the PO. Why should I again putting another thing? Design, plan, apply, all are there. Sir, oh, tutorial mein dekhenge. Sir, tutorial mein dekhenge. Kyunki abhi sir waiting for that. So remember that. Now you got the purpose, no? Purpose is this. PSOs are learning outcomes not supported by existing curriculum, learning opportunity provided beyond curriculum needed for attainment of PEOs. This is why you will be writing. What you will be writing? Based on what resource you are having, because you have to have that outcome in your students. Okay? So, these samples are examples are there, and this I am leaving because you told 10 minutes. So preparing CO I am keeping, because if I start CO I'll take another half an hour time. That is okay. So this is up to where I stopped. If I get a chance, I can share with you the how to prepare CO, or yeah. Or in the tutorial, before starting the tutorial, we can have a little more discussion on that. Thank you very much. Okay, if you have any question, please ask me. Please ask me, or I keep the questions in that for the tutorial class. Okay? Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am, for providing such a vast information of BE and preparing the POs. Now we have another speaker of this session, Professor B.S. Sohi, with us. And before he started presentation, I would like to introduce him. Professor B.S. Sohi is currently working as a Pro Vice Chancellor, Chandigarh University, from 2012 onwards. He is a graduate of Punjab Engineering College, Chandigarh, in year 1971, and PhD from Punjab University, Chandigarh. He started his career in Defence Research Labs, Hyderabad, having worked on prestigious projects like surface-to-air guided missiles, signal processing. He joined at Punjab Engineering College, Chandigarh in 1976, and then onwards worked in premier academic institutions. He became the founder director of University Institute of Engineering and Technology, Punjab University, Chandigarh. He has contributed significantly in various aspects of academics, like setting of state of arts lab, initiating new courses relevant to industry research, etc. He has guided 11 PhDs and he has 158 research papers He has also contributed in consultancy, academic planning, etc. He has been the member of various academic bodies at national level. He heads NBA visiting teams very frequently, and presently at Chandigarh University, that is having the strength of 26,000 new students, he is contributing to academic administration. I welcome you, sir, and now I request Dr. P.K. Singhal, sir, Head, Department of Electronics Engineering, to welcome Dr. Sohi with flowers. Now I request Professor Sohi to please take the dais.
Good afternoon, all the honorable members here. Maybe my lecture will be quite disappointing because I don't have the PPTs. And I don't have any prepared lecture for you on role of teacher and outcome education. I would like to share some experiences with you, what we have to do here. Of course, we all of you are teachers and we know our role quite a bit. We will use that. Then I'll share what we do at Chandigarh University. Chandigarh University, of course, has grown very. Yeah?
Mike, then. Start with my institution first. We started the university in 2012 with 2500 students, and within 5-6 years we have reached 26,000 students. So it is doing the things differently. That's why we have that growth there. Chandigarh University, I'm just introducing that, is focusing on the placements of the students. And we have held the Limca Book of Records for a number of companies visiting us. Every year there will be around 500 companies visiting Chandigarh University for placements. Then 5,000 placements last year because the number of students were lesser. So why I'm mentioning this is because ultimate goal of the teacher is to prepare the students for their ultimate achievement, that's a placement. So how do we prepare them as teachers? How do we go differently from the conventional way of doing it? A teacher needs to know what my student knows. Everybody knows it, of course. I am just repeating it. And what they can do. Then I set my target as to what I want them to take to the level. What else do I want to add them to so that they can do something which I want them, which they cannot do beforehand. So that is the intended target I fix, and accordingly I work on the teaching learning activities and tasks accordingly. So this is what in brief a teacher needs to do. A teacher needs to understand what are the weaknesses, like what we do there in Chandigarh University. The students come with, when they get admitted in different courses, we have as a university we have so many courses. courses, around 100 courses we done there. Mainly it's engineering, about 3500 intake, and then management, law, agriculture, management, hotel management, tourism, architecture, films division, animation, biotechnology, pharmacy. When number of courses are very high. So whenever the students come, we try to assess them right in the beginning. This is what AICT is saying now in the new model curriculum. So what we do is that we give them a test right in the beginning. There are two types of tests. One is their communication skills. One is their technical knowledge in the area. And accordingly, we segregate the students. Because each student will not be having the same background and cannot learn at a speed one wants when we put them together. So we intentionally segregate the students and then assess as to what inputs should be given to each group. There can be very fast learners, there can be very slow learners, and there will be average learners. So number being large, so we can segregate them into the certain groups, and accordingly we plan for them. Today in the industry, if we reach them out, like we reach about 500 plus companies coming there, so for that we try to assess the requirements of the industry. There can be very niche industries which pay very highly but pick up very few. Their demands on the capabilities of the students are very high, and others who can be average packages. There can be others who can be just getting the. It starts from something like 2.7 lakhs to 2.75 lakhs to 31 lakhs the packages the students get. So this is how we start with. We segregate them, and then accordingly plan is made for each sort of groups there. Now, as I told, that teacher must know as to what do the student they know and what they can do, and then what do I intend them to do, at what level I want them to take to. For example, we segregate this onto two parts. One is the fixed sort of curriculum execution, that is the curriculum we have designed. So basic sciences, engineering sciences and other things. And along with this, we go in for their weaknesses like quantitative mathematics. You get the students from different areas, their quantitative mathematics varies a lot. So then we have special teams who will work on their quantitative improvement. I tell you, the students cannot find out LCM, HCF, things like that, which they are supposed to do in schools. So this is first assessment that we go in for of the students. And then accordingly the teams separate, this is a separate team of about 100 trainers regularly there in the university. We have around 1100 teachers. So these 100 trainers focus on their quantitative skills, their communication skills, their soft skills. These are the different areas. Apart from their initial training, one vertical goes like this, that apart from their initial training, they are given the exercises, directed exercises to raise their level, and again continuously assessing them. It's just not that we give a test and the assessment is done. It's thoroughly discussed. Every student's progress graph is maintained through software, and we know who are the students who are going up, who are not going up. If the student at the average level progresses with sorry So we assess them, and if the student progresses very well, then can jump onto the higher level. If someone is not doing very well, can go down. So it's a sort of self-correcting competition for them. So they have to work hard. The communication first, then soft skills and quantitative mathematics, this goes on. And this is compulsory for every student to follow up to 4 semesters. It is applied type of exercises that go in the 3rd and 4th semester. First is the general, then applied type of exercise given to them for their logic development, which I consider is the most important in engineering. So they compete, solve those problems. Problems are also designated easy, average, higher, then very difficult, like this. If the student is not able to solve a problem at a level, then level of the problem is lowered. So this is again worked out. So of course we take the help of external agencies for this also at times. But the training goes by with the trainers only. So up to 4th semester it is one vertical that goes on. Then we assess them through an external agency whose scores are normally accepted by the industry, by the industry directly. If that agency says that the student has scored in English, language and quant, or logical and quant, like this, the company calls the students directly for the interview without written test and other formalities. So that is the advantage of that, or credibility of the test. Since that is again without rigorous training, then they know, every student knows with a full progress report, I am standing here in communication, I am here in logical, GD and all that, and then I am here in mathematics, where do I lack? Then we ask for the option of the students, you want to go for placements, or you want to go for higher studies, you want to go for entrepreneurship or the government jobs or something. Then we provide the facilities to each of these groups separately. For placements for the companies, we do not allow the students to sit like that, okay, I go and sit in this company, no. One has to show a progress through the external agency test that one has reached this level only. Those groups are presented to the companies of the caliber. Like Amazon offered 31 lakhs, so only 10 students were there in that, only one was picked up. So like that, the segregation of the students. Then we call this a training for placement program. And the students, then only those who opt for placements, campus placement, they are trained there. They are trained rigorously, I should say. Extra time from 4:30 to 6:30, and during the daytime whenever the classes are free. Then at the end of every semester, there is an external agency assessment of those students. They can go up, they can go down, so they know what is the progress. Each student knows where one has to work harder or so on. Their mock tests internally they go on. So by the time they face the companies, they would have appeared in 4 external agency assessments. So the best students, like if I start with 200 students from first year in IT, then they'll be scrutinized, they'll be dropped, and ultimately maybe 20 are left with who are top-notch students. Then of course their day-night exercises start, their even vacations are cancelled, frankly speaking. They are trained like that. So success is that 4960 students were placed last year, and process is on now. So number of companies I've told you, like Amazon, Google and all those companies are coming. It's not only IT, but almost any sphere of engineering or any sphere of courses that we offer. So this is one aspect of the preparation of the student. Now Now, second aspect is the academic part. Companies, they bother about what are the, are they crossing the first level, that say their personality test, that is GD, communication, quantitative skills and all that. But that's not going to be, that's just a qualifying thing. 50% of the total score for selection is based on this. Then, we in parallel run the IT courses, like we go for the logic development, then computer programming for all the students for 2 semesters. Then we introduce programming and logic development for every branch. Like if a mechanical person has to do an experiment, one has to write the flow chart for that algorithm, that I will take these steps and I'll solve it like this. So one is clear enough as to how to operate, how to solve the problem. So accordingly, then the student is allowed to do the experiments. This is the IT part. Then this is the two languages, C, C++ are compulsory, of course. Then we give the option to them to learn any other language. Nowadays it's Python, of course, is very hot. Java has been very prominent. Since we have dominatingly CSE students, so this is focused on IT. Lot of companies pick up the IT students. So this is another part of their preparedness. Right from first year to sixth semester, this goes on. It is very, very comprehensive for circuit branches, we call as that is computer science, IT, electronics, electrical and all. But others, yes, they are having the inputs like I've told you. They have the option to join the classes for different languages and some other subjects of computer science, so that if a civil person is not placed, one is in one's own branch, at least one has the option to go for another area. At least plan B for the student to not to sit home but to join somewhere. And in fact, today I don't think there is any company that does not require the IT skills. Then third part is the actual technical component, that's of the branch specific area. Now again, for this what we do is specific subjects are taken, their tasks are prepared, and specific preparation for the subject they go on. We call it as in engineering practice, we call it as whatever I have studied in the previous semester, there will be a review, official review of this for the next semester. So all those subjects one has studied, so those are being tested along with. Internal tutorials are being given for all those subjects so that one is in touch with the previous subject. By the time you reach the placements, then you have everything with you. You are not just out of touch with the subjects. So this is how they are prepared for the technical part. Now, going for the skills, like what do we do differently? We do not fix the experiments for the students. Right from day one, of course, broadly the topic is given. The students are expected to work on that small experiment with the guidance of the student, the teacher. And then they have to choose the components. Doesn't matter if they are not able to do many practicals, but very few. But they are able to choose the practical, the components, the equipment of their own with the specification. Why should I choose this? Why should I not this? Specification, data sheets of the components they want to choose. So everything is emphasized upon. Maybe one is able to do 5-6 experiments in a semester, doesn't matter, but one has to work for it. It's not the simple operation. Equipment is there, I just go and then this take the readings and come back. So that sort of input that we had seen, that the students merely go there and have a table, fill up the readings, and maybe they pick up the readings from somewhere else, and the teacher just scores and that's it. But here a teacher is required to work on the plan. If I am offering this practical, why should I be offering this? What should the students do in this case? Of course, being conscious that they are not capable enough at the moment because they have come in the first year. So they might have done some practicals of physics, chemistry in the plus two, but now here it's going to be different. The students have not to be guided always, but they expose themselves to know about and work on the experiments. Then again, right from the second semester, each student is encouraged to do a very, very small project, so that one is introduced to the word project, problem statement, constraints and things like that. Even if they assemble something, a known project, doesn't matter, but a procedure followed. When we checked with the universities abroad, they go up to something like 14 steps of implementation of the project. That's the prototyping and marketing and all that. So we start with the very few steps, one or two, three steps of project development. How to define a problem, how to find the constraints, how to see whether what are the expected results, whether you have got it or not. So all these things the students have to justify. So that is small project the student, maybe a group of 2-3 students or a single student, so they are able to do it. Even aerospace, they make their small prototype or sort of non-working model of aircraft or whatever they want to do. They can fire a missile up to certain height. It's known thing, known material, but they experiment it like that under the guidance of the teachers. So starting from very beginning, these are the small projects which are not accounted for, of course. They are encouraged that the student should be doing it. Of course, the students who do it, they are marked out and they are taken to be serious students and they worked on differently. But right from beginning, we have made at least 5 projects from 4th semester onwards officially in the curriculum. So any student who has entered 4th semester has to take the project independently and go through those processes. Not all the 14, but some of them. Next semester, one can expand on the same project, one can or take a new project with a higher level of its implementation, then 6th, 7th and 8th. So this is an inculcation of the experiential learning for them, that I must know, I must do something of myself. I must apply my knowledge, whatever I want to do. So normally I have seen, I was in Punjab Engineering College earlier and I was the director of UIET. So what we did was a single project in the 7th semester and 8th semester. That was not good enough. That was our assessment, that does not push the students to appreciate the value of the project or doing the practice of the things the way it should be. So this levels of projects, that pushes the students to do a practice on the job. They involve all those GAs, whatever number of steps that we can apply. So they are, of course, on the way, they are being sensitized about these requirements. That's the outcomes. So whatever outcome we target, the teacher targets, the teacher has to do it before. Rather, what we do is, like the semester is going to be, teaching is going to be over by 11th of April. A teacher will not be going on vacation. if he has not shown the preparedness. This is the advantage or disadvantage of private university, of course. One has to show the preparedness of the next semester. All the experiments are designed. Why? All this is evaluated by the committee of the department, and then the teacher, he, she has to ensure that the experiment is doable. The equipment is working, and he, she knows what should be the outcome. And then when the teacher comes in the semester, then these experiments need to be carried out, designed by the students. I know how to, what the students need to do. So accordingly, the teacher has to plan for everything so that the students are guided accordingly and they design their experiments. It's not a complete design, of course, but under the guidance of the teacher. But advantage is, student is involved in the doing of the practicals, appreciates what's the importance of a particular experiment that one has to do. So this is carried out right from first year onwards. Another thing that we have implemented is mixing the theory and practicals. Some of the subjects we do not hold it in the lecture halls. The theory is taught in the lab and the students are expected to implement it right there. We did a pilot project on this in electronics, and I can tell you the success. Those students who followed it very well, all of them were placed. Although there are not many companies for electronics these days, those are coming for recruitment, but all of them were placed in the electronics companies because they implemented the things. Because they implemented the things that they, it was, the way it was to be. So that is the advantage of holding the classes long, not all the subjects of course, but some of the experiments where you have the lab, we try to integrate it, the theory with that. That means I am teaching something, let's say I am an electronics engineer, I am telling about the transistor, what is the transistor and all that characteristics. Then let you set up the things and get the actual characteristics on the way and see if they are conforming to the same that I have taught you. It's not a one-way dialogue like in the lecture we have, but it is a problem is thrown to the student, a small issue is given, okay, you try to solve this, try to implement this. The teacher is available, yes, one is available even up to 8 o'clock at night, yes, it is happening. But the student is not given a ready-made solution. The student has to struggle. If I have to choose a component, I have to struggle seeing the data sheet of the component. I have seen myself with the 46 years of experience that the students coming out of engineering institutions, mostly, I am not saying everybody, they do not know what the data sheets are of the components and how to choose a component for a particular application. So these things are inculcated in them. Everything is available in the lab. Everything is available. You ask for it and the teacher will make the material available. They will tell you the site or the company's portal where the material can be found. Ultimately, I have to implement. Then, similarly, the language learning. It was a wonderful experience, I tell you. We give them as initial exposure and give an applied problem. It could be an application of something, and then the student has to segregate the actual problem statement from the vague definition of the problem and then find out the procedure to do along with the constraints and whatever that's there. And if one is able to do a few problems, one is confident enough. So So it's not the board teaching that the teacher carries on, but this way, I tell you, we did not introduce Python, the language. Out of 90 students, 63 students got the certification from outside, and 75% of them were placed in the company. So this is the success of the procedure that we follow for the training of the teachers. I am nobody to tell you, because you are all teachers, you are experienced, but I am sharing my own experiences with you. Labs are open for them, anytime they can walk in. Equipment is available to them. Being a private university, we push it. We push the students to do the competitive projects. Like, everybody does it, but normally we are a little unconcerned, or sometimes our hands are tied that we cannot really support them the way it is. I was the director of UIET, Punjab University. The students did the all-weather vehicle, all-terrain vehicle. They designed it and they spent 30,000 from their pocket. I could not support them because the rules didn't apply, allow me. But in Chandigarh University, being private, the students designed a moon buggy. Have you heard of moon buggy competition by NASA? The students designed moon buggy. They said, we want to go to NASA and compete there. I talked to my chancellor. I said that this is the group of students who wants to work on this. He said, so sir, can they win it? Are they serious? I said, it looks like they are serious. Now, this is how the things work. He said, if you think they are serious, let them not spend a penny from their pocket. Now, systematic design was taken. They simulated whole of the moon buggy. Now, what is moon buggy? It's a manual driven vehicle. That is why one girl and one boy, they have to synchronize their push, and they have to run it on a moon-like surface. You never know, it's unpredictable surface. It can be loose soil, like it is there. So they have given some sort of photographs. So you have to design your vehicle accordingly so that you can reach the target. I'm proud that there were 15 entries from India, and I was the only one that completed that. But before that, how did we do it? We had the mechanical software, we simulated the vehicle, they then implemented it, one vehicle was made, and then they ran it around in the college. Then problem was that how are we sure that the vehicle will withstand the area or the tests that will be there. So we made a moon-like surface in the university itself. We selected 4 girls and 4 boys, team of 8, and fixed their diet, gave them free hostel. Every day they have to run the vehicle for 4 hours and fully supported by the university. Then, because first one was just the first prototype, so improvements were carried on. Second model, it went very well. Whatever the defects, those were removed. And then it was to be sent to USA a month before the competition. Then issue was that if the vehicle goes, where will they practice? A third vehicle was fabricated. One was sent to USA, and third, the students ran around and broke it, everything. They practiced. Now the result was that we were second of the first timers, first in Asia teams, and 12th overall in the world. So that was the success. Now, all of the expenditure of the students, of their travel and registration, and the faculty, that was borne by the university. It cost us something like 8 lakhs. But that was the success. The students, what I am trying to emphasize is, they were guided how to do a project, what are the tests, procedures that you have to follow, how to be physically fit to run that, because you have to run it, after all you will be exhausted. So another vehicle that was designed was in Colorado. It stood first in the design in IIT Delhi, and then we were encouraged that the project is good, so we implemented and it went to Colorado, and it was 7th in the world. Again, it was supported by the university. So you need quite some freedom to implement this, finances also, but at the same time the systematic procedure, systematic guidance of the teachers, so that the students learn it. The students learn it very well. It's not that you win or you lose. It is how do we go about a teacher has to be fully involved with this. Unfortunately, as teachers, including me, we take that, yes, I have taken my lecture, I have taken my practicals and my job is over. But if you get involved with the students' projects like this, because we are the ones who know how to do a thing, so they can do a wonder. So my talk about the direction is that the teacher's role in outcome-based education. Now, when the student passes through all these stages, like from the day he has university, the guided tour of the student through 4 years, how to do the things, they learn all those honorable ma'am had given a right here. I was intending to do that, but she has already covered helping me there. So this is what we are. We train our faculty. It's just not unfortunate thing about the engineering is that I pass out ME and do PhD, I am pushed to class. I am selected, the next day I am in the class. I am not prepared. No, I am left to myself what to do in the class. I am a freshman. I am not confident. I do not know what to do in the class. I have no guidance. But we have, being an autonomous institution, we have opened up a separate institute called the University Institute of Teacher Training and Research. The role of this institute in the university is to plan the training of the teachers. Unfortunately, I have realized it after 18 years of my teaching that we do not know how to teach. It's a one-sided communication. I know my subject very well, so I am teaching it, and I am teaching at a stretch. I do not know whether the students are receiving it or not. They are assimilating whatever I am saying. I am master of my subject. I tell you my example. I have the microprocessors, if electronic people we know that. The first microprocessor came into the market in 1971. And I was fortunate to work in the defense labs. I worked on the first processor in 1972. So I have been into this. I must say I have quite a control, mastery of microprocessor areas, I must say. Now once I was taking the class, it was 3 periods and 4th period is on, I am teaching them. Because for me, everything is known. A student smiled and I burst on him. I said, you know how much effort I am putting in, and you are laughing and you are not serious. And he was one of the toppers of the class, of course. Banged him and I said, I am not going to teach now. He came to my room. He said, sir, may I tell you the truth? I said, what? He said, sir, three periods are not the time when we can assimilate whatever you are saying. So it's not that the teacher knows. It's I have to see whether whatever I say it's assimilated by the students or not. That is one very, very important point that I started with, that I must know what is the capability of my student today and where I want to take them to. And then what's the path I follow? Have I have the patience to know whether whatever I want to do it, it's being done? That is the assessment part of it. So very important. Assessment tasks to be designed by the teacher. It doesn't matter if we teach lesser. It doesn't matter if you don't cover the syllabus. The students can do themselves, I tell you. Today, every material is available. Any material is available on their mobile. That's really not an issue at all. One of the industry persons, he came and he was lecturing to the students. He said that our teachers, they will say that the present teachers, students are not serious. Present teachers, students are not very serious. They don't take the things seriously. When we were there, like I did my degree in 71. So when we were studying, first we had to rush to the library and then get the book, get it photostated, and photostating was very, very difficult machine. So with so much of difficulty, get the material, then read it. Then he said the question is that you spent a lot of time on gathering the information rather than assimilating it or preparing it. Today, material is available. Why should the student spend time? He should be able to spend that much time that you were spending on understanding the things. So that's what we need to appreciate, that today, how do the students want to be taught? A discussion at my university, at the Chancellor, Vice Chancellor, my level, is how they want to be taught. We must understand their aspirations, what they want to be taught, how they want to be taught. So unless we understand that, we cannot serve them really. If the teachers take this much of interest, it must be quite unbelievable to you, maybe I'll take it, but sincerely I'm telling you, we run the survey every year on the students, their satisfaction level, different parameters, academic, sports, hostels, this, that. We get the results of satisfaction up to 80 to 85%. Unbelievable for us as well. So this is the dedication of a teacher, that if you are able to plan for the students, guide them the way you want, and then try to know whether the students know this much which you are going to tell them, or they want something else, and or wherever you are starting, whether they know it or not. So that also is very important. So you have to go down. It's just not the state-directed approach that yes, I have prepared this lecture, I am delivering it. Unless until I have some assessment tool to know, maybe every day, maybe fortnightly, maybe monthly, maybe whatever the time, whether whatever I wanted to do, it has been done or by the students or not. This is so very important for us. So unless we know this, the student, the job is not done, whatever we are. I may sit cozy today, but as in Western countries, the best universities are the private universities, I tell you. Everybody knows anyway. And this is going to happen. I have spent my life in government institutions. For last 10 years, I am in a private institution. And I can bet it that the private institutions, some of them will beat, they'll go to the top notch. This will be surprising, but my own assessment is like this, because in private they hire the talent whichever is available. wherever it's available, at whatever cost it is available. The country head of IBM has joined us now because we wanted him to plan for us, and we don't mind the money he wants. So this is what needs to be done. Yes, in government, I have been a part of government, it cannot be done so easily, but at least at our level I can plan my own activities with some constraint, of course, with some certain constraints of the government organization, like extra time to be given to the students, the labs to be opened afterwards, all those things may be some constraint, but I would recommend that we must share these things with the students, that unless they do it like this, they cannot be succeeding. Another very, very important area. The world is changing very, very fast. Very fast. Let me disclose here. We have MOUs with 170 universities, 177 universities world over, and 50 of them having QS ranking. It's just not for the sake of it. Around 800 to 1000 students go abroad for a semester, and we have the flexibility of accepting their assessment right here. So that's one connect that we have. Because we are the private university, we can do it. Bigger than that is the connect with the industry. Unless, until I know what does the industry want, my students are not going to be fitting into there. We have created a corporate advisory board. It started with 36 members around 4 years back. This time, I'm sorry, I couldn't prepare for these things because of this meeting. We got freed only on this Sunday. 96 members of the corporate, they were there. Now overall we have something like 176 or something like, in which there are MDs, there are CEOs, there are presidents, vice presidents of the sort, of the companies, whichever you name. You talk of Microsoft, Google, you talk of Amazon, talk of anybody. Those are the members. Now, what do we do with them? This is part of what academicians must plan. I know the constraints in the government, but what do we do? We throw the issues to them, challenges to them, that what should the university do to face this? In the area of research, what should we do? In the area of international competition, the outsourcing getting closed, issues at the national and international, we send them a month before. They come prepared, they come for 3 days, one evening and 2 days full. Then we divide them into small groups. They put their views together, we type them, collate them, and discuss it with them, that this is what corporate wants. This is what corporate wants. Afterwards, we shall start the action taken on them. And on the way throughout the year, we shall send them the action taken and their views. As a result of this, few things have happened, because in the beginning, industry does not believe you. They think that you are inviting them for placements, obviously. But by and by, when they saw the activities, what the expectations of the university, they started reacting because they are the very, very senior persons. So what they did was they sponsored certain labs in the university. Microsoft, IBM, HP, HPS Open Center of Excellence, Hyundai, Honda, different areas of engineering and this tourism, hospitality, so many areas. About 28 labs we have partially supported with by them. Another advantage of those labs that they start sending their own experts for the conduct of it. And they allow our teachers to be trained there. We send our teachers to Bangalore, to Bombay, Hyderabad, wherever the are closer to us, Gurgaon, wherever they are. So teachers go there for 1 week, 2 weeks, for a month or so. So teachers are trained on different technologies. Like Wipro, another activity they do is pre-placement, pre-deployment sort of activity. Now what is done in that case is, they select the students of their by their own process. Then normally the companies put them on training at their campuses for 3 months or something. But now we say that we are going to do that job for you. They train our teachers. Like Wipro wanted full focus on Java. So we trained 25 teachers from them, and those students who were selected, 573 students were selected. So those students were trained by us, by our own teachers, and assessed by them. It's no obligation on them that they should pick up every student. If we have trained them, they are shortlisted, of course, but if the student is not progressing, then they will not pick it up. So they can assess it. Not only Wipro, but many others, Tech Mahindra, so many companies are there who are doing it, ITC, and so on. So this is another interaction with the industry. Now, we were talking to the industry country head of one of the units. We said, what will be your selection criterion tomorrow? He said, this year, last year I came, there was a weightage of 70% for soft skills and 30% for the technical. And this year I'm coming with 50-50%. And next year, technical will be 70% and your soft skill will be 30%. Now, unless the teacher knows this, you cannot prepare them in that direction. If I lay the emphasis only on the soft skills, the students will not be able to do it. Now, day before, they said, we said, what will happen to, what will be the future of placements? Particularly in IT we were talking about, because I am electronics. They said, your programming skills and things like that, or coding skills will be gone. Automation is coming very fast, machine learning is coming very fast. So unless you prepare your students in those areas, reorient your courses, we will not be able to pick up your students. So unless until teacher knows what is required by the industry tomorrow, you cannot really prepare the students fully well. So that is the role of this teacher, to reach the industry, get trained on the different new technologies, and then plan for the students. After all, what is the job of the institution is to train the students, enable them through all these projects and classroom, whatever we are, to enable them to be placed. 90% of students want, 80-85% students want to placement. Some of them, of course, go abroad, and we have a very good technology incubation center, of course. We got 10 crores from Department of Science and Technology. We have set up, there are startups coming out of that. We go for the training of the students for IELTS, other things, foreign languages, English, whatever they want. Because size being bigger, good number of students for every activity are there. Say one wants to go for banking, this placement bank officer, so we train them for that. And tell you, university does not charge anything for these things. If it is done by our own teachers, it's done by them free. But of course, if you want help from outside, bit of charge is there. So focus of the teacher as to what does, what is it that I have to prepare the student for. Because if the teacher does not know this, if the teacher does not know what I am preparing for, then it's a waste of time for the students, frankly. So this is another activity we do, that we get closer to Corporate Advisory Board. Of course, now the Corporate Advisory Board is around 176 or something. So we have split into two. CEOs and MDs are coming on next Sunday, Sunday, and others were there this week. So this is comprehensive exercise to get closer to the industry. And once they know that you are sincere in doing your things, they help you a lot. Another activity that we do with the students is, we were running a class of mechanical students. I was there to do a workshop. I was the guest there. The teacher asked them, there were 120 students of mechanical engineering. He said, who has taken mechanical engineering as a branch of choice? Only two students raised their hands. Out of 120 students, only two students raised their hands that, yes, I have taken mechanical as the branch of my choice. This is shocking. Now the student never knows where one has to land, what is there in the store. So then we decided, let's run some activity for them to make them aware as to what is there in store for this branch. If you want to change after first year, you can change it. So we invite the industry people, we call it as corporate mentoring. They come to us, let's say a person from electronics industry comes, all the fellows from electronics, they'll be addressed by, say, whatever the branches, so we arrange that. It's a very hectic activity, every time someone is coming for some branch. So the student knows, if I carry on this branch, what's there I'm going to face. If I am not interested in this, let me change it now. There is a fancy to go for computers, but if I am not a good logical developer, then I cannot carry on there. So they know it right from first year. By the end of the second year, first year, again there is a comprehensive exposure to the students about the branches. Then we have divided our curriculum in the sub-verticals. That means from fourth semester onwards, I shall offer some specific subjects in some areas, like in electronics I can say wireless communication or some other areas. So a focused select electives are given for three semesters, so that one is focused in a particular sub-area of the branch. Then another important area that the teacher needs to focus, sorry, it's my views, I'm just sharing it with you, whatever we are doing. Another area a teacher needs to know or needs to appreciate is the horizontal development of the students. One is vertical in the one's own branch. Again, in the horizontal direction. Let's say a mechanical engineer, he wants to do some subjects of computer science. One can support it. One wants to do some subjects of civil engineering. We call it as open electives. They are offered. At least two open electives for each student. One can go for a hobby subject. One can take, one can, engineer can take a management course. First year, no, we have a list of 40 subjects. We ask each branch that what is the open elective you want to offer. So this is a list. The students by April, May, they gave us the choice that I am going to join this. So we accordingly plan it. So open electives, connect them with the other branches. In fact, we know that it's quite a constrained area. The total time with us is very constrained. So if a student wants, I cannot offer all the subjects to all. So if they want to go into certain other direction, they can choose some subjects. This is another area that we have done is minors. Minor branch, let's say mechanical engineer. If he wants to take a minor of civil engineering, he has to do some 6 subjects in addition to whatever they're doing. So then you have a minor of civil engineering. Or electronics person, he wants to do the minor of computer science, can do it. So that sort of versatility, the width to the students of his one's own choice, so that is available to the students. Yes, it is written. Yes, it is written. This is the additional subjects. We charge for that for that matter, because we have to put the teachers there. So they are given a separate certificate of the minor branch. Yes, let's say normally it is something like 28-30 periods you engage in a week. So other 6-7 periods, so that those are left, so there are 1 or 2 subjects in each semester they can carry out.
Whether the students are completing their
course in
4 year duration?
4 year duration. Only 4 year duration. These are the extra load they take. Credits, yes, extra credits.
Coming,
they have to be.
What is the attendance?
Oh, well, yes.
Let me put it.
Slogan at Chandigarh University is 74.9 is not 75. Honestly, I am looking after this. If someone says that meri dadi mar gayi, main bimar ho gaya, we say that 25% is meant for that. The student knows before joining that this is going to be a tough time. Lightly side of this, a student put on the Facebook, should I join Chandigarh University? A student of Chandigarh University wrote back, this is somehow, I know, don't join Chandigarh University if you are not a serious to me, honestly. That means 75. We give the relaxation of 10%. But in very, 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 very exceptional cases, like the fellow's leg is broken, you are out for 15-20 days. Very, very few cases. Very few cases. But everybody knows 75% means 75%. Yes, it is there. So there is no compromise on this. Another thing we have done is, I have been in Punjab University. A student can reach 8th semester if he has a repair in 1st semester. I don't know the relevance of 1st semester subject when he is passing, when he is in 8th semester, right? So what we have done is, if you are not achieving 3.5 grade point average in the first year, you are going to repeat the year or you are going to leave the university. Leave the university,
you are not promoted
to second year. If you are not achieving 3.5 grade point average, you are not promoted. Simple. We lose 400 students every year. We have our intake something like 10,000 or so. 400 to 500 students. It's a loss of around 10 crores every year. Things like that. But this has allowed us to maintain the level. Yes, one can join. One can join afresh. That year is gone, fee is gone.
Again you have to register.
Yes, again
the
rule.
Pay the fee,
attend it and then... yes. In second year again.
How many times? How many times?
One leaves.
Suppose one is failed. Less than
how does it matter to me if he does not goes on repeating, let him do it.
There will be some chance,
not
2 chance, 3 chance.
In first year, if it's the student, I count the chances.
Ex-student.
Like?
in our university there is a provision, if CGPA is 5 or less than 5, then the student is not promoted to second year.
Yeah, right.
But he can reappear in all the subjects. Or
no. No, it's not. One has to join the classes again. One has to join the classes.
Credit system?
Yes, we have the relative grading. Relative grading. Yes, credits and relative grading.
Yeah. So if you clear the course, you will get 3-4 credit.
If you get overall credits, 3.5 grade point average, if you relative grading it is. So if your grade point is not less than 3.5, you are going to repeat the year. Similarly, at the second year level, it's not that one has attended and will appear in the examination. We are very clear on that. If you have not achieved the grade point average of 4, you are not promoted to third year. You will repeat whole of the semesters of second year. It's complete repetition, goes to that work class. So it's nothing that I am left with the backlog and I am going ahead.
Suppose if one or two subjects he is not able to mark, but his total grade is 4.
That's fine.
Then he is allowed to.
That one is allowed.
And he not to appear again in the subject.
He has to. If you are not getting at least D grade in the subject, you are not exonerated. You have to clear that. But what we do is, we allow them the summer term. At the best, three subjects you can appear in summer. Is it working?
No,
I think
the voice is clear.
Okay, fine.
It's okay, sir. Isko rakh dijiye, karta
rahega. I have to clear all the subjects. If I am not getting at least D grade, I have to reappear. But the